The opening prayer will be given by the Reverend Dr. Joseph P. Lee, Jr., Senior of the Historic Bank Street Memorial Baptist Church in the city of Norfolk. Welcome, Dr. Lee.
Good evening, everybody. Good evening. I just walked into the building, so excuse me if I appear to be out of breath a little bit. I hope I look okay. I didn't get a chance to check my hair or anything.
Part straight.
Brother Mayor, and of course, members of the City Council, the City Clerk, all those assembled here this evening. Good evening.
Good evening.
Let us pray. Almighty God, creator and sustainer of the universe, look down upon us with your mercy and grace this evening. Bless us with the presence, the patience, and the power that you deem necessary to maintain peace and harmony and love among us. Let your wisdom help to guide our mayor, our city council, and our city leaders tonight, that everything that they do and everything that they act upon will be pleasing in your sight. Bless all the citizens represented here tonight, that they too may sense your presence and guidance as well. Guide us in the way that you would have us to go in moving our city toward a bright and prosperous future for all. We thank you for the opportunity to serve you and to serve your people. Allow us to serve and to govern according to your perfect and holy will, and we'll forever give your name the praise, glory, and honor. It is in your matchless name we pray, and your people say it together.
Amen.
Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Lee.
All right. God bless you.
You might want to get the phone. We're getting there.
Mr. Clerk, please call the roll.
Ms. Doyle?
Here.
Ms. Graves?
Here.
Mrs. Johnson?
Here.
Ms. McClellan?
Here.
Mr. Riddick?
Here.
Mr. Smeagol?
Here.
Mr. Thomas?
Here.
Dr. Alexander?
Here. The motion is to dispense with the reading of the minutes of our previous meeting.
Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Graves?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan?
Aye.
Mr. Riddick?
Aye.
Mr. Smeagol?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye. Mr. Clerk, please read the resolution certifying the closed meeting.
I have a resolution certifying a closed meeting of the Council of the City of Norfolk in accordance with the provisions of the Virginia Freedom of Information Act. Adopt the resolution. Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Graves?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan?
Aye.
Mr. Riddick?
Aye.
Mr. Smeagol?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye. Good evening. For the benefit of those who do not regularly attend the Norfolk City Council meetings, our procedure is to first take up ceremonial items. And tonight, we are proud to have two of them. Next, we'll take up public hearings, then the consent agenda, which will be voted on in a block. If any member of the council or the public wishes to discuss an item, that item will be removed from the consent agenda and considered separately. Following the consent agenda, we then take up the regular agenda items in the order as they appear on the docket. Upon the completion of the agenda, we then take up any new business to come before the council. To address the council, you should have registered to speak outside in the council chamber before 7 p.m. When your name is called, please come to the podium, state your name and your address, and please limit your comments to 3 minutes. Tonight, we're pleased to have two ceremonial items. We have with us tonight Maury High School football team champions and the Lake Taylor High School football team champions. I will invite Dr. Sharon Birdsong, superintendent of Norfolk Public Schools, and senior athletic coordinator Steve Sutt Miller, please come to the podium. And let's bring up the head coach, Derry McCann, and the athletic director, Edward Board.
All right.
If I can have all the Commodores to stand.
Mamie, look at you.
Mamie was the first one to stand. I have a resolution, but before Coach, Dr. Birdsong, Mr. Sutt Miller, if you want to make any comments, Please do, and we have a resolution that we'll share.
Good evening, Mayor Alexander, members of council, Dr. Filer, our community members. We are very excited to be here with you this evening. We have two championship teams to celebrate with you. We have Lake Taylor High School, who is a 4A state champion. They have won this title for 3 years, and so we're very excited about the Lake Taylor Mighty Titans. So let's give them a hand, please. Also with Maury High School, we have Diaree McCain, our illustrious coach, with us here this evening. And this is the first time that Maury has won a state championship since 1933. So that is something to be commended and celebrated. And while we're here to celebrate our athletic abilities, please know that both of these schools are fully accredited. These children are students first, and we applaud their efforts for making their education a priority. And so Steve Sutmiller, our athletic director, has a couple of comments as well.
First of all, I just want to, again, thank you for allowing us to attend this ceremony. It's been a routine here for us, and we're real proud of that, and we hope to be back in March with some basketball teams for you to celebrate. But just wanted to let you know, this is that state championship on that Saturday for the city was the first time any city in Virginia won two on the same day. So the accomplishments go beyond thanks. I mean, the two teams, Coach McCain, Coach Sawyer, passionate coaches, and they do the right thing for their student athletes. So we're proud to have them as leaders for our students. So now it's Doree's turn.
Thank you. I just want to first off thank you guys for having us. We appreciate the opportunity. Just a bunch of guys who just work hard. Obviously, you have to do that in order to win a championship. But not only on the field, they do it in the classroom. And that's one of the things I'm proud about. And more so those guys being leaders. I'm hoping that they, you know, end up leaving if it's not NFL or if it's not, you know, football. I just hope that they're leaders. Somebody that's from the city of Norfolk, I went to Sewell's Point. I went to Rosemont, I went to Blair, and then I went to Maury. So I'm a kid that's from here, happy to give back to the community, and I'm hoping one of these guys can, or a couple of these guys can do the same when it's their time, whenever they're done with football. So these guys are great leaders, they're great men, they're great people, and I'm proud of what they've done outside of, you know, winning a championship. So I think that's what it's all about. You don't win a championship if you don't have guys like that. So appreciate these guys. I know they're glad about the opportunity to be here, and we just appreciate everything you guys do for us.
Thank you. Great. So we have a resolution. Stay right there. And we're going to read the resolution, and we're going to.
And the acting principal, Lakeisha Lawrence.
Yes, please.
If you want to come up, Ms. Lawrence.
And I'd like to recognize our building principals.
Yes,
we have with us today our illustrious principal from Lake Taylor High School, Letitia Wade Jenkins.
Yes. Yes.
Karen Berg is not with us today physically, but she is here in her heart. She's here. And we have the assistant principal, who is our acting principal at this time, Letitia Leek Lawrence.
Wonderful.
And I failed to mention Hank Sawyer, but
I'm going
to
call him up.
Yes, we definitely appreciate Hank Sawyer and his leadership. Thank you, Mr. Sawyer.
We're going to have the Titans to come next. So let me, resolution, City of Norfolk, resolution. Whereas, under the leadership of head football coach, Maury High School alum, Doree McCann, the Commodores completed an outstanding undefeated season at the VHSL Class 5 Football Championship at Hampton University's Armstrong Stadium on December 14th, 2019. And whereas, in a competitive head-to-head match against Stonebridge High School Bulldogs, the Commodores demonstrated exceptional talent, skill, determination, strategy, and passion as they fought their way to reestablishing their championship reputation and making history. And whereas, closing out the game with a final score, 28-21, Commodores rose above the challenge to defeat their opponents and earn the team's first state football title since 1939. And whereas this is a momentous achievement, which every player, staff, member, administrator, parent, and supporter of the Moore High School Commodores should be proud. Now, therefore, be it resolved, Section 1, that the Council of the City of Norfolk hereby extends heartily congratulations to the Moore High School football team, Coach McCann, and his staff, and their historic 2019 BHSL Class 5 Football Championship, Section 2, that this resolution be recorded in the permanent proceedings of the Norfolk City Council, and that a copy be presented to Coach McCann, his team, and his staff. Congratulations. Councilwoman Johnson, would you join me with the presentation?
I most certainly will.
Mr. Mayor, may we adopt the resolution first?
Yeah.
Thank you.
We have to vote?
Hand them.
Yeah.
One.
Yeah. Clerk, call the roll.
Adopt the resolution, Mrs. Doyle?
I'm gladly voting aye.
Mrs. Graves?
Aye.
Thank you. Mrs. Johnson?
Definitely aye.
Ms. McClellan?
Congratulations, gentlemen. Aye.
Thank you. Mr. Riddick?
Aye.
Thank you. Mr. Smeagol?
We were all Commodores that day. Aye.
Thank you. Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye.
Thank you.
Council, please rise and take a picture. Team, come on up. Fill in. Coach, come on up here.
Get them in here. They got to back up.
Yeah, y'all gonna have to go like to the left, scoot over to the left.
She said used to lead it.
There we go.
Zamari, some can go up the front on each side of the aisle.
Having the surgery until they won the championship, and she told the boys last summer she wasn't going to get into the aisle.
Right,
that's
yours.
Literally,
yeah.
In there.
Yeah. On each side of the aisle.
You did under it.
The kicker.
Oh, right.
I gotta get out.
Yeah.
1, 2, 3.
All right. Okay, thank you.
They've pulled everybody up. They're just waiting outside.
A couple injuries. Oh, these poor kids. It never ends.
And now we have Lake Taylor's head coach, Hank Sawyer, and the athletic director, Bob Pinnebacker. Bob Pinnebacker, please come forward. Bob here. Dr. Birdsong, please stand again.
My principal can come. Yeah,
principal, athletic coordinator.
Dr. Birdsong, let me raise the microphone for your remarks.
Now, Dr. Birdsong, you can present Hank Sawyer if you want.
Good evening, Mayor Alexander, member of council, Dr. Filer. Once again, we are here to celebrate the wonderful achievement of Lake Taylor High School. This is their third state championship, and we are very excited about all that the football team has accomplished, in addition to the wonderful grades that they have been able to achieve. Hank Sawyer has led this team for many, many, many years. He is a wonderful person and a wonderful coach. And so I'd like to give him an opportunity to share words along with the principal, Mrs. Wade Jenkins.
Welcome, Coach. And will the mighty Titans please stand? And all the members of members on the council who went to Lake Taylor, please stand.
Hello.
Oh, he's standing.
I love it that you're standing. We know that you are a Titan. I just want to thank you all for this opportunity. I'm very proud of my students. Every time I see them play on the football field or when they're in classes in school, they just motivate me to continue to dig deep to make sure that they receive the very best. I'm very proud of each and every one of my babies. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, good evening. First of all, I'm surprised but happy, Dr. Alexander. Now, congratulations on that title. Most of you know me, and if you don't know me, I guess that might be a good thing. But anyway, we're happy to be here today. Just thank you for having us down, both teams. I'm excited about the city of Norfolk in our world, academics and athletics. It's taken us and has bought us. Let me say, it all starts and it ends with love. The love I have for my assistant coaches, the deep love I have for my players, for Lake Taylor High School, for our students. For love is not a word you hear on a football team, but is what America lacks. And so I put everything that we do in practice, classroom, cafeteria, we put love in it. And if you don't believe us, I welcome you to come out and spend some time with me. I may burn your ears, but I think it'll be an enjoyment for you. So thanks for having us.
Thank you.
City of Norfolk, Virginia resolution. Whereas after earning its first state championship 2012, another in 2014, Lake Taylor High School Titans returned to the VHSL Class 4 Football Championship December the 14th, 2019 to pursue its third state title. And whereas in an exciting head-to-head match against the Tuscarora High School Huskies, the Titans band together under the direction of head coach Hank Sawyer and demonstrated exceptional talent, skill, determination, strategy, and passion as they fought their way to reestablishing their championship reputation and making history. And whereas, determined to make their fourth championship appearance in 7 years a success, the Titans scored the game's first three touchdowns and secured an insurmountable early lead. And whereas, despite their opponent's persistence, the mighty Titans triumphed and ended their impressive 13-2 season with a remarkable 34-14 victory and proudly claimed their third state championship title. Now, therefore, be it resolved, Section 1, the Council of the City of Norfolk hereby extends warmest congratulations to Lake Taylor football team, Coach Sawyer, and his staff, and their 2019 VHSL Class 4 State Football Championship, Section 2, that this resolution be recorded in the permanent proceedings of the Norfolk City Council, that a copy be presented to Coach Sawyer, his team, and staff. Clerk, call the roll.
Adopt the resolution, Mrs. Doyle.
I happily vote aye.
Mrs. Graves.
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson.
A pleasure, aye.
Mrs. McClellan.
Congratulations, team. Coach, aye.
Mr. Riddick.
Aye.
Mr. Smeagol?
We've been Titans since the first time you ran, so we just weren't Titans that day. We've been Titans. Aye.
Thank you. Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye. Council, please stand. Team, please come forward. To the council, I don't know if it's ceremonial, but after we take pictures with the team, Coach DeRee and I from Moore High School, we have a little presentation for the city council. So after the team, if they could join us down on the floor, that would be fantastic.
Fine.
Okay.
You both didn't help us.
Can you all come back so you all can see?
So if you can't see my lens, I can't see
see you, so you can kind of sweep.
You guys see the photographer. He
y'all are taller than Maury. Who has more titles now? Hey, Hank, how many, who has more titles, you or your wife?
My wife.
That's always a good answer.
How you doing?
Great.
Always a good answer.
Good to see me.
Bye, Dr. Birdsong.
Thank you.
Thanks for being here.
Thank you.
Good to see you.
Okay. Well, we want to read. Okay. If you don't mind, just go ahead. Okay.
Okay. Oh, look at these.
One represent all. Well, each member of the city council here today will receive one of these 2019. Cool. Lake Taylor High School, Moore High School,
VHS awesome.
State right. Championship T-shirt.
Cool.
And on the back it says, one day, December 14th, 2019, one city, Norfolk, Virginia, two teams, two football state titles.
Wonderful.
All right. All right. Yeah.
I saw that on Facebook.
Well, all you all have my
thank you.
Right.
Very
y'all
nice.
Y'all come up here. Oh. Nice. Let me take a picture. Hold on.
Okay. All right, everybody.
Just the way doing it again. Some swag.
Are we good?
Very nice. All
right. Thank you, guys. Thank you, coaches.
Okay. Yep. Good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Is that the teach?
Congratulations, coach.
I played basketball in high school, but I was a golfer.
Great.
I played golf in college.
You did?
Yeah. Westminster College, in Pennsylvania.
Yeah. Do you still play golf? Or do children?
Not very much.
Children take that sport away? Of course it takes it.
This is fun.
Yeah. Hope they got a 3X on them shirts.
You can get.
Huh?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. The door.
Mr. Clerk, IB1.
IB1 is the receipt of bids pursuant to invitation to bid and notice of public hearing scheduled this day pursuant to state law. Public notice having been inserted in the local press by the city clerk to accept bids for a long-term parking agreement with the term of 20 years for the lease of up to 81 spaces in the Commercial Place Garage located at 820 East Main Street, 118 parking spaces in the Fountain Park Garage located at 130 Bank Street, 91 spaces in the Waterside Garage located at 50 Martins Lane, and 89 spaces in the Bank Street Garage located at 441 Bank Street in the city of Norfolk, Virginia, subject to certain terms and conditions.
Mr. Clerk, how many bids have been received?
I've received one bid.
Please read the bid and mark it for identification.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, I represent McKinnon Tire LLC, a Virginia limited liability company. This is from Williams Mullen, their attorney, enclosed on behalf of McKinnon Tower LLC. It is a bid in response to the invitation to bid and notice of public hearing for a long-term parking agreement with the term of 20 years for the lease of up to 81 parking spaces in the Commercial Place Garage located at 520 East Main Street, 118 parking spaces in the Fountain Park Garage located at 130 Bank Street, 91 spaces in the Waterside Garage located at 50 Martins Lane, and 89 spaces in the Bank Street Garage located at 441 Bank Street in Norfolk, Virginia. And I will mark this as well. Williams Mullen and representing McKinnon Tower LLC.
Are there any additional bids offered? If there are no additional bids offered, I declare the bidding closed. Is there any member of the public who wishes to be heard on this matter? If there's no member of the public who wishes to be heard on this matter, I declare the public hearing closed. Is there a recommendation from the staff regarding the bid received from McKinnon Tower LLC.
Yes, Mayor, Council, City staff recommends that the bid by McKinnon Tower LLC be reviewed by the City staff and a recommendation be made to the Council at the February 25th, 2020 meeting.
Is there a motion to continue this matter until the next meeting of the Norfolk City Council on February 25th, 2020 to receive recommendations of the staff and to consider the bid from McKinnon Tower LLC?
I so move.
Is there a second?
I second the motion.
Is there further discussion? If not, clerk, please call the roll.
Motion is continued to February 25th, 2020. Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Graves?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan?
Abstain.
Mr. Riddick?
Aye.
Mr. Smigiel?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye. Mr. Clerk, PH 1.
Public hearing one scheduled to stay under the state law. Public notice having been inserted in the local press by the city clerk on the application of Bryn Shore Development for a rezoning from regional commercial to downtown St. Paul and for a conditional use permit to allow more than 24 dwelling units on property located at 450 Posey Lane. And the Planning Commission recommends approval by 5-0.
Mr. Clerk, call the roll.
I have two ordinances. An ordinance to rezone property located at 450 Posey Lane from regional commercial to downtown St. Paul's district. Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Graves?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan?
Aye.
Mr. Riddick?
Aye.
Mr. Smigiel?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye.
Second ordinance is granting a conditional use permit to authorize multifamily dwellings on property located at 450 Posey Lane. Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Graves?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan?
Aye.
Mr. Riddick?
Aye.
Mr. Smigiel?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye. Mr. Clerk, PH 2.
Public hearing 2 scheduled to stay under the state law. Public notice having been inserted in the local press by the city clerk on the application of Bryn Shore Development for a rezoning from regional commercial to downtown St. Paul's and for a conditional use permit to allow more than 24 dwelling units on property located at 501 Wood Street. And by a vote of 4-0, Planning Commission recommends approval.
Mr. Clerk, call the roll.
I have two ordinances. An ordinance to rezone property located at 501 Wood Street from regional commercial to downtown St. Paul's district. Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance adopted on the effective date. Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Graves?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan?
Aye.
Mr. Riddick?
Aye.
Mr. Smigiel?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye.
Second ordinance is an ordinance granting a conditional use permit to authorize multifamily dwellings on property located at 501 Wood Street. Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Graves?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan?
Aye.
Mr. Riddick?
Aye.
Mr. Smigiel?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye. PH 3.
Public hearing 3 scheduled to stay under the state law. Public notice having been inserted in the local press by the city clerk to hear comments on authorizing the conveyance by the City of Norfolk to Norfolk Redevelopment and Housing Authority of those certain parcels of land located at 501 Wood Street and 450 Posey Lane in the City of Norfolk, Virginia, authorizing the City of Norfolk to enter into a cooperation agreement with the Norfolk Redevelopment and Housing Authority with respect to Norfolk Redevelopment and Housing Authority's use of the properties and authorizing the city manager to execute the deed and cooperation agreement on behalf of the city.
Clerk, call the roll.
I have an ordinance authorizing the conveyance by the City of Norfolk to the Norfolk Redevelopment and Housing Authority for those certain parcels of land located at 501 Wood Street and at 450 Posey Lane in the City of Norfolk, Virginia, authorizing the City of Norfolk to enter into a cooperation agreement with the Norfolk Redevelopment and Housing Authority with respect to Norfolk Redevelopment and Housing Authority's use of properties and authorizing the city manager to execute the deed and cooperation agreement on behalf of the city. Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Graves?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan?
Aye.
Mr. Riddick?
Aye.
Mr. Smigiel?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye. PH 4.
Public hearing 4 scheduled to stay under the state law. Public notice having been inserted in the local press by the city clerk to hear comments on the application of the monument companies for the following applications at 435 Virginia Avenue. 2. A. Amendment to the future land use map within the city's general plan, Plan Norfolk 2030, from industrial to multifamily. B. Rezoning from IN to conditional MFAC and for A. C. Conditional use permit to allow more than 24 dwelling units, and Planning Commission recommends approval by 5-0.
Clerk, call the roll.
I I have three ordinances. First, an ordinance to amend the city's general plan, Plan Norfolk, so as to change the land use designation for property located at 435 Virginia Avenue from institutional to multifamily. Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Graves?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan?
Aye.
Mr. Riddick?
Aye.
Mr. Smigel?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye.
I have an ordinance to rezone property located at 435 Virginia Avenue from institutional to conditional multifamily apartment complex district. Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Graves?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan?
Aye.
Mr. Riddick?
Aye.
Mr. Smigel?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye.
I have an ordinance granting a conditional use permit to authorize multifamily dwellings on property located at 435 Virginia Avenue. Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Graves?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan?
Aye.
Mr. Riddick?
Aye.
Mr. Smigel?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye.
Public hearing 5, scheduled this day under the state law. Public notice having been inserted in the local press by the city clerk on the application of Enjoy Church for a change of zoning from institutional to conditional single family 6 at 112 East Bayview Boulevard, and the Planning Commission recommends approval by 5-0.
Call the roll.
I have an ordinance to rezone property located at 112 East Bayview Boulevard from institutional to conditional single family 6 district. Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Graves?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan?
Aye.
Mr. Riddick?
Aye.
Mr. Smigel?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye. PH 6.
Public hearing 6 scheduled this day under the state law. Public notice having been inserted in the local press by the city clerk to hear comments on authorizing the vacation and release to Norfolk Terminal LP of a portion of utility easement located at 600 Ford Drive in the city of Norfolk, transferring ownership of the pipe within the vacated easement area to Norfolk Terminal, and authorizing the conveyance to the city of a new utility easement over the property.
Call the roll.
I've an ordinance authorizing the vacation and release of Norfolk Terminal LP of a portion of utility easement located at 600 Ford Drive in the city of Norfolk, transferring ownership of the pipe within the vacated easement area to Norfolk Terminal, and authorizing the conveyance to the city of a new utility easement over the property. Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Graves?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan?
Aye.
Mr. Riddick?
Aye.
Mr. Smigel?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye. Page 7.
Public hearing 7 scheduled this day under the state law. Public notice having been inserted in the local press by the city clerk on the application of the city of Norfolk to vacate a portion of the right-of-way of Mayflower Road between Virginia Avenue and Carolina Avenue at 38th Street.
Clerk, call the roll.
I have an ordinance closing, vacating, and discontinuing an unimproved portion of Mayflower Road. Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Graves?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan?
Aye.
Mr. Riddick?
Aye.
Mr. Smigel?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye. PH 8.
Public hearing 8 scheduled this day under the state law. Public notice having been inserted in the local press by the city clerk to hear comments on approving a First Amendment lease between the city of Norfolk as landlord and National Railroad Passenger Corporation as tenant, so as to extend the term of the lease for certain property located at 280 Park Avenue, Norfolk, Virginia, for one additional period of 5 years, and authorizing the city manager to execute the First Amendment to the lease on behalf of the city of Norfolk. And the staff has asked for this item to be continued to February 25th.
Motion is to continue to February 25th. Clerk, call the roll.
Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Graves?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan?
Aye.
Mr. Riddick?
Aye.
Mr. Smigel?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye. Mr. Clerk, C1 through C8 will be considered in a block, excluding C9. C9 will be considered separately.
Okay, approve the consent agenda and dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinances twice and adopt with the effective date, with the exception of C9. Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Graves?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan?
Aye.
Mr. Riddick?
Aye.
Mr. Smigel?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye. C9.
C9 is an ordinance amending the FY 2020 Annual Appropriations Ordinance Number 47636,
so as to accept appropriate and authorize the expenditure, appropriate and authorize the expenditure of grant funds up to the sum of $161,500 from the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation and previously appropriated local matching funds in the amount of $290,000 and in-kind services in the amount of $20,000 for the Norfolk Green Infrastructure Plan project.
LSW James.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. My name is Ellis W. James. I reside at 2021 Kenlake Place here in the city of Norfolk. This letter from the city manager and an ordinance entitled an ordinance amending the FY20 annual appropriations ordinance so as to accept appropriate and authorize the expenditure of grant funds up to the sum of $161,500 from the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation and previously appropriated local matching funds in the amount of $290,000 and in-kind services in the amount of $20,000 for the Norfolk Green Infrastructure Plan project. This is a very important item. It's an important project, and I would urge the council to vote unanimously in terms of appropriating and authorizing the funds. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Mr. James. Mr. Clerk, call the roll.
Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Graves?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan?
Aye.
Mr. Riddick?
Aye.
Mr. Smeagol?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye. R1.
R1 is an ordinance accepting the bid submitted by Mobile Lighting LLC for a long-term wireless facilities franchise agreement with a term of 10 years with up to 3 renewal terms of 5 years each in the city's rights of way. Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Graves?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan?
Aye.
Mr. Riddick?
Aye.
Mr. Smeagol?
Just a quick question. I don't know if there's anybody here. I don't see Frida from Public Works, but are we keeping track of in the city of where these towers are going up? Because these are the 5G towers, and they've been, I don't know if you've seen some of them, they're pretty ugly. We're getting the regular telephone pole ones with the brown, actually, Chip, you pointed one out to me when we were on our tour of Ward 5. But I think this might be the third or fourth company, if I'm wrong, that we've approved to allow this access. But are we making sure that we're not going to have a block where there's like four of these up on there? I mean, I want the competition, believe me, the 5G, but are we making sure that this is not going to look pretty ugly in our city? Is there anybody here to answer?
Yeah, sir. So we, as these come in, you know, they do go through a right-of-way process, and so we know exactly where they're headed, and you know, we are keeping track of where these requests are coming, or where they're asking to go, I guess is a better way to put it. So, you know, one of the things we probably could do is to map them, okay. And we could show you all a map, yeah, of where they are currently and where we have some proposed.
Because I know Verizon announced they have them over on the west, correct, side of the city. But I do think they have towers in some other parts. They just haven't expanded yet. But it would be good for us to know.
Yeah, I'll
that.
Work with staff, yeah, and we'll see if we can put a map together of the ones that you have approved and where,
sure,
they are.
Okay, thank you. Aye.
Thank you. Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye. R2?
R2 is an ordinance accepting the quitclaim to the city by Monument Development 18 LLC of any interest it may have in the vacated portion of Mayflower Road to be vacated at 435 Virginia Avenue in the Colonial Place area of the city. Dispense with the charter requirement for reading the ordinance twice and adopt with the effective date. Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Graves?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan?
Aye.
Mr. Riddick?
Aye.
Mr. Smeagol?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye. R3?
R3 is a resolution accepting the final Hampton Roads Region Norfolk and Virginia Beach joint land use study. in which the city participated with the City of Virginia Beach and with the United States Navy and the Hampton Roads Planning District Commission.
Ellis W. James.
Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council, Mr. City Manager, my name is Ellis W. James. I reside at 2021 Kenlake Place here in the City of Norfolk. This is a very important item, as brief as it is in its written form. Letter from the City Manager and resolution entitled A Resolution Accepting the final Hampton Roads Region, Norfolk and Virginia Beach joint land use study in which the city participated with the City of Virginia Beach and with the United States Navy and the Hampton Roads Planning District Commission. We have a very fine representative who sits astride this situation and awareness. I would hope that the City Council would vote unanimously because of its importance that I'm sure all of you have been made aware several times. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Mr. James.
Mr. Mayor, if I may,
yes.
Sir. Mr. Ellis, you have three representatives on the Hampton Roads Planning District Commission. Councilwoman Courtney Dole, and I also, along with Councilwoman.
My apologies for missing you all and leaving you out. I'm delighted that the three of you are on this commission, and I think that just adds to the glamour that I hope the City Council will show in its vote. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Mr. James. Mr. Clerk.
Thank you.
Adopt the resolution. Mrs. Doyle.
Aye.
Mrs. Graves.
My glamorous vote is aye.
Mrs. Johnson.
My smart vote is aye.
Mrs. McClellan.
I just wanted to note this joint land use study is the first of its kind. There are many joint land use studies throughout the United States. It is the first one in the country to focus on flooding specifically. And it's we are looking at the roads, the access roads to our naval bases in Virginia Beach and Norfolk and how they're affected by flooding. And hopefully we will find some federal dollars to help deal with that as a result of this study, just as a point of reference and a PSA. So yes, thank you, Ellis. I vote aye.
Mr. Riddick.
Aye.
Mr. Smigel?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye. R4, Mr. Clerk, we have a statement. Once you read the caption, I'll read the statement how we proceed.
Well, I think we're waiting.
I'm not kidding.
Go ahead and read the caption, and then...
I have an ordinance to grant a certificate of appropriateness authorizing exterior alterations to a multifamily building located at 508 Graydon Avenue in the historic district.
This item is an appeal of a decision of the City Planning Commission regarding an application for a certificate of appropriateness. Our procedure for this item will be as follows. The city may present a summary of the application and the proceedings before the city planning. Next, the person noting the appeal will present his or her case. Several people may participate, but the entire presentation shall last no longer than 15 minutes each. Member of the public who signed up to speak on this item will then be individually called and may comment on questions of whether or not the appeal should be approved. Each speaker comments will be limited to 3 minutes. Following all comments by the public, the applicant will be given an opportunity to provide a rebuttal limited to 3 minutes. Following the rebuttal and any discussion or questions by council members, a vote will be taken as whether whether the appeal should be approved. So Dr. Filer or someone from the city is going to present? Mr. Pishkin.
We don't have any more presentation than what we gave to you on the process earlier, so that we were planning on your only hearing from the applicants if they are here.
I don't see anybody for R4, sir.
No one signed up. I don't have any signed up to speak.
They're not here.
Yes, I don't see anyone for R4, sir.
What's the recommendation of the staff?
So the recommendation of the staff was to approve the appeal.
Okay. Mr. Pisco?
Unless there are any questions, we're ready for the vote.
Yeah. What year was the house built?
Nineteen ten. Give or take.
1918. You're pretty close.
Okay, Mr. Clerk.
An ordinance to grant a certificate of appropriateness authorizing exterior alterations to a multifamily building located at 508 Graydon Avenue in a historic district. Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Graves?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan?
Aye.
Mr. Riddick?
I think if we start tearing down these historic districts and for alterations, and then after speaking to one of my colleagues, nobody, and the person that owns the property doesn't live there. So I'm gonna vote no, and I hope that in the future we'll recognize the importance of these historic districts. No.
Thank you. Mr. Smigel?
Just a quick question, Courtney, Councilwoman Doyle. Is the house next door to it painted? I think in that first picture, there's a house right to the left of it.
I don't know if the masonry is painted, but it looks like the whole house has a single color paint. Okay. Yes.
And on that street, are there other houses that are painted?
Yes, there are. Numerous. There are.
Numerous, okay.
Numerous, yes.
Aye.
Throughout the neighborhood.
Thank you. Mr. Thomas?
No.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye. Mr. Clerk, do you have any
of R5?
R5, yeah.
And an ordinance approving the assignment by Norfolk Southern Railroad Company to McKinnon Tower LLC of that certain garage parking agreement between the City of Norfolk and the Norfolk Southern Railway Company for a lease of 500 parking spaces in the Commercial Place parking garage located at 520 East Main Street in the City of Norfolk, Virginia, and authorizing the city manager to execute the assignment and modification of the garage parking agreement on behalf of the City of Norfolk. And Mr. Mayor, the staff has requested that this item be continued until February 25th, 2020.
Motion is continued until February 25th. Mr. Clerk, call the roll.
Mrs. Doyle?
Aye.
Mrs. Graves?
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan?
Abstain.
Mr. Riddick?
Aye.
Mr. Smigel?
Aye.
Mr. Thomas?
Aye.
Dr. Alexander?
Aye.
That's all I have.
All right, we are have new business. When your name is called, please come to the podium, state your name and your address, and please limit your comments to 3 minutes. Sheila Riley.
Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Sheila Riley. I live at 1609 Kingfisher Court in Chesapeake. And I want you to know that your decisions impact neighboring cities as well. I was asked to share my perspective as someone who has always hated guns. My husband was a hunter, and I wouldn't allow his guns in our home with our children. That was an attitude that I would come to regret. We had a home invasion several years ago. That early morning, I thought my husband was going to be shot. We didn't have his hunting rifle because I didn't want it in the house with our kids. And I didn't know if I regretted that thinking more when the deputies were going through our home, room by room, looking for more intruders, cocking their rifles with each door opening or command, or when I heard the helicopter flying over our neighborhood. Glowing spotlight in the pre-dawn hours. I am a disabled woman. I can't run, I can't duck, and I can't dive. And I still hate guns. But I hated that feeling of vulnerability even more, and I will never be in that situation again. Like most gun owners, we legally purchased a gun. I took a class to learn how to use it. I still didn't feel comfortable, so I took another class. And I kept taking those classes until I not only felt comfortable, but competent to handle that weapon. More than 99% of legal gun owners in this country are competent as well. They recognize the responsibility and respond accordingly. Tonight, I am asking you to respond accordingly. Our family's safety and security are our main priorities. If we are not allowed to lawfully own a firearm, then the only ones that are going to have them are the unlawful. Those who we need protection from have already proven that they don't comply with the laws. Not only are they targeting us, but our government is targeting us as well. We need you to recognize our needs and ask that you respond accordingly. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Mark Edmond, followed by Jeffrey Burke. Mark Edmond, followed by Jeffrey Burke.
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, my name is Mark Egeman. I reside at 2416 Number 10 Lane in Chesapeake. I come here before you tonight as a concerned parent. We have a young adult son who lives and works in the city. Our son works at MacArthur Mall, where twice in this past year, he has called us from a broom closet while gunshots were being fired. In both cases, the shootings turned out to be a result of gang-related activity. One of those shootings was inflicted by a convicted felon in possession of a firearm. So when certain voices tell us they want common sense gun laws, a reasonable person would assume that we are focusing on the criminal, that we want to make it difficult for them, deter them from getting guns, that we want to take their guns away from them. Senator DeStef introduced a bill that would invoke a mandatory 5-year prison sentence for anyone carrying a concealed firearm in the commission of a felony. A good, common sense bill. That bill was tabled in committee without discussion, along with a number of other good, common sense bills that would fight crime. Meanwhile, a bill that will provide, reinstate the parole system and early out for convicted criminals, murderers, and rapists is working its way through the General Assembly, apparently unimpeded. Other bills also working their way through the General Assembly will do nothing about crime, other than generating a new class of criminals from people like me. House Bill 961 seeks to criminalize us for things that we lawfully possess now. The new majority is intent on ramming their agenda through the legislative process while claiming to have a mandate despite a low voter turnout of about 40% statewide. The real graph of the will of the people regarding the gun control issue can be seen in the Second Amendment Sanctuary map, where 96% of localities have adopted a resolution. When confronted with the inconvenient facts, they often respond or with additional punitive measures. House Bill 1627, if passed, will now make it a Class 1 misdemeanor to use electronic communications to mock or speak out against the governor, lieutenant governor, attorney general, or members of the General Assembly under the guise that this is considered harassment. Ladies and gentlemen, the stench of corruption emanating from our capital in Richmond stinks to high heaven. And this is why we need the support of our local governments to stand with us as we call out for accountability and we seek legislation that will actually do something about crime. In closing, I would like to say that approximately 30,000 armed patriots gathered in Richmond this past Monday, the largest armed force to march on Richmond since the Union Army burned the city in 1865. Not one shot was fired, not a single incident, despite all the fear-mongering from our governor, who ironically was nowhere to be found. In fact, a number of Democrats were also decidedly unavailable that day.
Mr. Eggman, thank you for coming, sir. Thank you for coming.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Jeffrey Burke, followed by Tim Oxford.
Good evening, distinguished council members, mayor.
My name is Jeffrey Burke, and I live at 2217 Haverford Drive in the city of Chesapeake. I'm here to speak on behalf and to encourage your approval of a Second Amendment resolution similar to what we've seen in the city of Portsmouth and the city of Chesapeake. I am an ardent proponent of the United States Constitution. I believe it is among one of the most well-crafted governing documents in the history of the world, and it provides a governing system that ensures good order and equal protection under the law for all American people. Our founders well understood the lessons of the defense against tyranny they had recently won for themselves in the War for Independence. The Second Amendment to the U.S. Constitution is an essential bulwark against the tyranny of a central government. As our founders had experienced, and as the history of the world has since then illustrated, one of the first things ascending tyrants do is to consolidate their power by disarming the citizenry. The process is usually gradual and seemingly reasonable, but the end state is always the same: the tyrannical oppression of the people who can no longer defend themselves or enforce their liberties. Across our beloved Commonwealth, Virginians are rising up to declare their support for the Second Amendment. The people are speaking clearly, and independent cities and counties are passing resolutions to that end. I'm very pleased the city of Norfolk is willing to listen and hear arguments on behalf of the proposals that we've seen in other cities. And I strongly urge you to lend your support and substantial influence, sir, to the passage of such a resolution here in Norfolk. We would be numbered here among the citizens who acknowledge the perils of state centralization, the hazards of patient gradualism, of tyrants and collectivists, and the utter folly of so-called gun control. I urge you to please move ahead on a motion to approve a resolution that would make the city of Norfolk a city that supports our Second Amendment rights, committed to respect, preserve, and uphold the Second Amendment to the United States Constitution and Article 1, Section 13 of the Virginia Constitution. Sir, as I was preparing to come over today, I stopped at St. Paul's just up the street here, and I was able to walk through the churchyard. I'm a student of history. I enjoy history immensely and the study of it. And I got to the place where there's this little sign that points up and it says Cannonball. And then there's a plaque, as you all know, on the building. And it says that Cannonball is there because a former Virginia governor had it fired there. And I would say that this city has a very real experience with a tyrannical governor. And I'm very fearful that we're facing a similar situation.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you for your time.
Tim Oxford, followed by Jerome Bell.
Hello, my name is Tim Oxford. I live at 8058 Carlton Street. I've been a Norfolk resident almost 40 years. I spent 8 years in the Navy, recruited out of J&F Shopping Center, and spent all 8 years here. 5 years at Little Creek Amphib, 3 years at Norfolk Naval. I want to touch on more of what Mark had said. He kind of stole a lot of things I was going to say, so you've already heard it. But I wanted to talk about more about Lobby Day. So many gun owners, a lot are in this room that were in Lobby Day as well in Richmond, that not one issue. I can't think of another group that gathered so many people without an issue that has in recent history when it comes to protesting something. All we see in the news is violence, not in Richmond. Everyone was, all these law-abiding citizens, like I said, many in this room, we went there to represent Norfolk to protest peacefully. And that's what we did. Norfolk is one of the last cities, municipalities, to pass anything at all. Last meeting on the 14th, Portsmouth became a constitutional city. Why not Norfolk? What is so different about Norfolk that almost all of Hampton Roads has become a constitutional city in some way or another? Oh, I thought that was my time. I've been reaching out to so many people trying to tell them this is not a party issue. This is beyond the left and the right. So I ask all of you to look beyond the party that you may be affiliated with and become a Second Amendment constitutional city for the American people. Not a Republican, not a Democrat, but all of us that reside in this great country. You have heard many from other cities talk tonight. Chesapeake mostly. I'm sure you'll hear from Virginia Beach and some other cities. We had asked them to come out as well because they could see that we're in trouble in Norfolk. They want to stand with us. But it almost seems like council, our city leaders, are not standing with us. So they come out to spread the word as well. That's why they're here. The oath that you took was the same oath that I took when I joined the Navy. And to me, it almost seems by ignoring what's going on in the state of Virginia, you are breaking your oath almost. The part that says, I take this obligation freely without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion. To me, not adopting anything or not even acknowledging it, truly acknowledging it, is evading your citizens, not protecting us and the Constitution. I understand that some of y'all have received threats. I am not that kind of person. I am totally against anybody who would try to cause you harm. But other city leaders, other council members from other cities have received threats as well, but they still stood by their citizens in becoming a two-way constitutional city. Thank you, sir. I do realize, this is a political statement, not a legal statement.
Sir, so you
would not be breaking anything for Richmond by standing with us politically.
Thank you, sir. All right. Jerome Bell, followed by Robert Broad Brown.
Good evening, Mayor Alexander. How you doing? And City Council. It's actually my third event today, so I'm a little winded. My name is Jerome Bell, and I'm a candidate. I'm running for Congress of the 2nd District of Virginia. In 1867, Frederick Douglass said,
Mr. Bell, can you tell us your address?
3053 Clark Drive, Virginia Beach, Virginia.
Thank you so
Sorry
much.
Sorry about that.
You're fine.
In 1867, Frederick Douglass said, a man's right rests in three boxes, the ballot box, the jury box, and the cartridge box. He understood that because in 1866, after the assassination of Abraham Lincoln, and when Andrew Johnson became president, down in southern Alabama, southern Georgia, the Southern Democrats started to use codes called black codes and black laws. Why? Because they didn't want armed black men, they didn't want freed blacks to be able to defend themselves with the newly passage of the 13th Amendment of the Constitution. Now, after 150 years of struggle, we've actually come a long, long way. But now we have a governor that's famous for blackface, a governor who pushes infanticide after birth. So how can we believe that he has our best interests at heart when he wants to bring in gun control? To me, I ask, why is he even still in office? Some things are okay when you're a Democrat, though. Now, this same racist governor and his overseers in the General Assembly have the nerve to attack free Americans, black, brown, white alike, pushing new and improved black codes, masquerade as red flag laws, magazine capacity laws, ammunition laws, purchase limit laws, and gun registration, all with the fear of prosecution if we don't comply. He even called a fake state of emergency because Patriots came to Richmond, like they have done for over 20 years to Lobby Day, to rally for their Second Amendment rights, while using linguistic programming words, labeling these Patriots as white supremacists and white nationalists. Well, I'm here to tell you, I'm a black nationalist, so I want to see how the Democrats try to spin that. And I was in the middle of it all. So what does that truly make me? We shouldn't even be here tonight. But since there's tyranny from King Northam in Richmond, we must. I ask you to pass a resolution to defend the constitutional rights of all of the citizens you represent. Tonight or tomorrow, you have a choice. You can send the message to Richmond that we as free human beings have natural law, an inherent right, a God-given right that's enshrined in the Constitution of the United States of America. Thank you very much.
Bob Brown, followed by Marcus Goin.
Good morning, Mr. Mayor. Good afternoon, Council. Distinguished guests, I'm Bob Brown, 8507 Troy Street. I'm chairman of the Republican Party at Norfolk, and I'm part of a new group called Norfolk Second Amendment Preservation Coalition. Excuse me, I'm trying to read my own writing. Second Amendment sanctuary city resolutions have passed in 138 towns and counties, almost 98% of Virginia. They are not like the petitions of an earlier time when both the citizens of Virginia and their elected officials implored their royal governor, King George, and Parliament to hear their petitions and grant them relief. The Second Amendment sanctuary city movement was started when legislators overreached and filed a plethora of gun bills that are onerous to our liberties. Governor Ralph Northam believes that Virginia localities have a duty to actively assist the Commonwealth in the enforcement of any law enacted by the General Assembly, whether constitutional or not. The vast majority of Virginia localities have made it clear that any attempt by the General Assembly to deny their Second Amendment rights, or the risk of turning law-abiding citizens into felons, would be ultra vires act, void, and thus not law at all. When a higher government authority overreaches, it is the duty of the lesser government to interpose themselves, to protect the people from the abuse of power to government, to give meaning to protections to the U.S. and the Virginia Constitution. The application of this principle set above is the Second Amendment sanctuary resolutions is clear. The U.S. Constitution and the Virginia Constitution are the statements of the will of the people themselves and the compacts from which the Virginia legislature draws its authority. You've been reached out to by dozens, if not hundreds of people going back close to 3 months now. I've been here three times. We were here 2 weeks ago. You opened us with welcome arms. Your fine clerk of true Virginia gentleman, Mr. Bull, was very gracious to us, and I thank you for that, Mr. Bull. We tried to come back. We were told we needed a permit, and we get hit with smugness, sleeplessness, or silence. Since this council refuses to act, the newly formed Norfolk Second Amendment Preservation Coalition tomorrow morning is filing a ballot petition called the Second Amendment Preservation Ordinance. Will Norfolk voters stand up? Please meet me afterwards and get copies of this petition. This will be filed with Clerk of the Court, George Surface, tomorrow morning. You've ignored us. You ignore us no more. We're going to collect our 1,250 signatures, as Andrea knows. I believe in referendum. I believe in direct vote. We're here, all of you here, to serve the people. So am I. Thank you for your time. Please see me after I'm done.
Thank you. Marcus Goin, followed by Aaron Goldstein.
Good evening. My name is Marcus Goring, 2249 Maple Street in Virginia Beach. I'm here to speak about the Second Amendment. We all spoke just now, the Pledge of Allegiance. And I want to point out a few words there. That is republic, indivisible, liberty, and justice. We live in a republic, not in a democracy. That's the first thing. Under God, not under government. Indivisible and the governor and his party of progressives are dividing us in an unprecedented way. It's more than a threat to our liberty. It changes the way we are governed. Justice, if these bills will go through, only will be granted to those who govern. Virginia's motto is Sic Semper Tyrannis, like on the flag behind you. Basically, what progressive Democrats want to do is take away all of those rights. They want to be tyrannous. Governor Northam requests to raise the budget to imprison gun owners for prisons. The plan to raise gas prices by 25 cents. And the most famous abortion bills that want to go through. And not to forget, of course, his blackface KKK. I don't know which one he is. Do you want to live in this kind of society? Under that kind of tyranny, I don't believe so. So I beg you to pass a bill that will not allow that. Thank you.
Thank you. Aaron Goldstein. followed by Bill Jackson.
Hello, members of Norfolk City Council. My name is Aaron Goldstein. I was born and raised in the city. I currently reside at 3015 Lorraine Avenue, Norfolk. January 20th of this year, tens of thousands of Virginia gun owners peacefully assembled in our capital to express their distaste for the myriad of gun laws being proposed in our General Assembly. I was there. I came unarmed to what the media was predicting was going to be a bloodbath because that was the only way I could talk to my representatives. When I got inside the Pocahontas building, much to my surprise, or not, none of my representatives were there. They didn't have the courage of their convictions to face their constituents and tell them why they were in favor of taking away our Second Amendment rights. So far, 91 counties, 15 cities, and 30 towns have declared themselves Second Amendment sanctuaries, or at least reaffirmed their dedication to the great Constitution of the United States of America and Virginia. I've come here tonight to ask you to bravely add our names to theirs, to either declare Norfolk a Second Amendment sanctuary, or as a minimum to publicly declare Norfolk as a constitutional city. In the last 30 days, there have been 5 robberies and a homicide within a mile of my house. I have the utmost respect for the Norfolk Police Department, but they're not superheroes. They can't hear my perils from miles away. They can't leap tall buildings to come to my rescue. In an immediate threat, I am my own best protection. These new laws seek to limit what I can carry to protect myself. The vast majority of our citizens will have to forfeit their firearms, and those that don't will be afraid to use them for self-protection, lest they themselves are charged with a crime. Criminals will not have that dilemma. New laws are on the books to be softer towards crime. For instance, they're trying to raise the threshold for grand larceny, a felony, from $400 to $1,200, and they're trying to make it easier to expunge criminal records. What type of message does that send to criminals? The burden of these laws will be on our city. Norfolk police may be called upon to search public housing for firearms, much like they did when the Brady Act was still in effect. Take a look, look it up. Citizens of Norfolk whose only crime was having a relationship go bad will have their home searched for firearms by the Norfolk police under the guise of red flag laws. So-called assault weapons bans will make criminals more reluctant to submit to police, thus putting our officers in an even greater risk. The Constitution of Virginia clearly states the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. I'm asking you to let someone else test the constitutionality of these laws. Refuse to use our precious city resources to enforce them. Send a message to Richmond that we're not interested in what rich out-of-town lobbyists want us to do. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Bill Jackson, followed by Madison Downs.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor.
Good evening, Bill.
Members of the council, Angela, Mamie. I'm here again. I didn't prepare a text, but like the last time I was here, I asked you 2 things. I asked you to contact your representative, tell them to vote no on all these gun bills. I'd like to ask you all tonight to see that ordinance for secondary or Second Amendment Sanctuary City Amendment gets on your docket and that each one of you vote for it. I've only got 1 thing that I can do if you don't, and that's to vote against you. And I will. Now, I've been watching the impeachment hearings on television and I learned something. I'm going to yield back the remainder of my time to whoever's behind me. Thank you very much.
Madison Downs, followed by Jim Letourneau.
Good evening. My name is Madison Downs. I'm running for the 3rd Congressional District here in Virginia. I'm out of 2709 Wickham, out of Newport News, Virginia. Well, I do want to give you guys kudos for being here. It's a lot better than what we saw when I was in Richmond last Monday. At least you showed up. I come to you today befuddled and confused. I know that as a military officer, I took an oath to defend the Constitution. I understand that your oath may be a little different in wording, where you may have to say verbiage such as support. But either way, it's to uphold the Constitution. And if we're on our oath and we consider Constitution, you have to consider also natural rights and common law. I'm concerned about codes and statutes. I was impressed by what Mr. Reddick said about preserving history and historical buildings. Well, when I think about certain codes and statutes that my people had to go through, homes were taken away, guns were restricted, and in each and every turn, there was nothing but peril that followed. These sorts of things led to things that our children aren't taught in school, such as the Gulf Wars, which then led to the Civil War. These are things that we're trying to avoid right now. When I look around, I see several concerned faces, and I think that on the council, we have people that really want to do what is in the will of the people. But I also think that there's a lot of fear in making the right decision. And I don't know if anyone has decided to perhaps set up some sort of a system where an ombudsman can speak with people or not in order to come to a resolution. But the Constitution clearly states that shall not be infringed. And shall not be infringed simply means you shall not encroach. If you encroach on one constitutional amendment, I'm afraid that there are several others that will also be encroached upon. We send our children to schools every day. I instill in my children certain values. I know for a fact as a teacher, I've seen it, where certain communities try to encroach on the values that I have put in my children while my children are in school, because I've seen it happen to other students. And I've had to fight against that. It's a very slippery slope that we're going down when we begin to encroach. So I ask that you not encroach. Just follow the Constitution.
Thank you, Mr. Downs.
Thank you so much.
Jim Returno, followed by Eric Hovick.
My name is Jim Returno. I live at 137 West Ocean Avenue in Norfolk. Mr. Mayor, Council, here we are again. Mr. Mayor, I'd like to thank you for having your office respond to my email request. And in the mayor and the council's defense, they did draft a letter to Mr. Northam. In your letter, you stated that the Norfolk City Council and the city attorney had no mechanism which they could violate our constitutional rights. And I respect that you come up a little short. That's not exactly what we're looking for. We're one of four localities in the entire state who has not taken a stance on this issue. Ladies and gentlemen, it's time to get off the fence. We have to address this. It has to be done, and it has to be done now. We can't keep coming back here for this, but we will if we have to. We don't want to put you out of office. We want you guys to stay where you at. We need your guys' support. And if there's any doubt in any of your minds, everybody behind us has your back if you have our back. We need you to represent us. If there's any question about what's going on in Richmond, look up House Bill 1627. He touched on it, making it a crime to criticize Governor Northam or his crew. Look up House Bill 842. As soon as this thing started, a petition came out to recall the governor. His immediate response the very next day was to initiate legislation to increase the numbers it requires to recall him from 10% of the voter population to 25%. All right. this is the face of tyranny that we're looking at. He is not going to stop. He's going to pass those bills. He's going to pass those laws, and he's going to expect you people to enforce them. And you can't do it. You have to protect us from that. This is what you're here for. We need you to protect us from that. If you do your job and you protect us from that, we got your back. There is no doubt that everybody back here will support you. We'll defend you from him if you need it. You can count on that. And I yield the rest of my time. Thank you, sir.
Eric Hovick, followed by Britt Edwards.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, City Council. My name is Eric Hovick. I live at 169 West Ocean Avenue, Norfolk, Virginia, 23503, if you want to send me a card. So this is the fourth time I've been here. I came in November, December, earlier in the month, and now. Sent a resolution to all of you, or at least my representatives, Mr. Smeagol, Mrs. McClellan, you, Mr. Mayor, and the city clerk. All I'm asking for you to do is vote on it. Like, put it on the agenda, allow people to speak to it, and then decide what you want to decide. Make a decision. I'm not trying to tell you how to do your job, but it's the Constitution. You don't have to agree with me. You don't have to vote the way I want you to vote. I just want it to be on the agenda, and I want it to be voted on. And this is the fourth time I have come to ask you, and I will continue to come. This is the largest fleet concentration area in the universe. This is the home of our military. We project so much might around the world, and we won't discuss an agenda item, and we won't vote. People die every day for this country. They do their job. Just vote. Just put it on the agenda and vote. Take a stand one way or the other. You don't have to agree with me. I just want it on the agenda, and I want you to say what you think. Either represent us or don't. It's the Constitution. This is Virginia. Our Constitution is older than the U.S. Constitution. The people that the heritage that you follow as elected representatives in this state, in this Commonwealth, it founded our country. It's the, you know, the frickin' sword and the kilt, and it's what it's all about. This is Virginia. Decide. Make a decision. Doing nothing and placating me and thanking me for coming. And I appreciate you being awake, Mr. Riddick, and it means a lot. Just put it on the agenda and vote. Take a stand. Be an adult. Be a representative. Or don't. Don't do it, but seek your fortunes elsewhere. Do something else that's going to be more palatable. Easier. Just do something.
Linda Edwards, followed by Josiah Hunter.
Hello.
Hi.
Brenda Edwards, 6127 Edwards Street, not on purpose. I don't know if y'all know this or not, in case you missed it. Y'all have pissed a lot of people off, and I'm one of them. I am a mother and a wife.
What city are you?
Norfolk.
Oh, thank you.
And it is appalling to me that you guys are not willing to do the proactive thing to make Norfolk safer by saying that we're a Second Amendment sanctuary city. This means a lot to people. This is basically, we are the litmus test for the rest of the country. Whatever we do, it's either going to go downhill or we're going to be protected. Y'all need to do something. We need to stand with the rest of the state. This is disgusting. And then everybody, like, all of you just look... If my mom was here right now, she would tell every single one of you to fix your face. Because y'all are just staring at all of us while we're up here pleading for our representatives to represent us and do something and bring a vote. And you guys are just staring at us like we're crazy and you're sick of hearing it. Do something. And I apologize if my voice is raised. I'm a loud person. I'm a little frustrated. Okay. You guys all have the luxury of having these two gentlemen here armed to protect you. And I don't know what you have going on outside anywhere else. I don't. I don't have either one of these guys until something happens to me and I got to make a call and hope to God that me, my child, my husband, anybody else in my bloodline and anybody that I care about, they can get to them. That is what all of this means. We are trying to make sure that we feel safe and we, oh God, so sorry. You guys, we are fighting for your rights as well. This isn't just us against you. Like, if you guys don't want to defend yourself, if you don't want to arm yourself, if you don't want to conceal carry, that is completely up to you, and I completely respect it. But I am not going to stop fighting for my ability to do it and yours. That choice is what makes America great. We get that choice. And you guys are just being passive about it. It needs to come to a vote. It needs to. You guys need to represent us, make us feel like we're represented. That's another part that makes this country great. We get to be represented. And it's not happening right now. My child's safety, my family's safety, your children's safety, grandchildren, everybody in your family needs to be protected. And if you guys don't realize that and you guys just want to sit back and do nothing about it, well, I hope that you're able to make it through life without having anything bad happen to you. But the odds are that's not going to happen. I just really, just like everybody else in this room, just need to feel the support. My dad always said, you don't have to like it, you just have to do it. If you don't agree with what I'm saying, you don't agree with their saying. Mr. Riddick, hey, what you doing?
Sir, ma'am, Ms. Edwards, hey. Your time has expired. Josiah Hunter? Followed by Mark Halstead.
Josiah Hunter, 301 East Randall Avenue, North Virginia. Mayor, City Council, thank you for being here. Thank you for listening to us. I'm not going to go over what I went over last time. I'm just going to ask you guys to represent us, to stand up with us. As a previous people have mentioned, we're here not just for our rights, but for yours and our fellow citizens. You're elected to represent the citizens of Norfolk. We're asking you to stand up, pass a resolution similar to what Chesapeake or Portsmouth, Virginia Beach has done, and say that you're standing with the citizens that you represent and that you value the constitutional rights that are afforded to all of us. And that's what we're asking you to do. Thank you. I yield the rest of my time.
Thank you. Mark Halstead, followed by Rick Williams.
Hello, Mr. Mayor. My name is Mark Halstead. I'm at 609 Mariners Way in Norfolk, Virginia. I guess I'm here to speak about the things that my predecessors have come about. Mr. Mayor, dead people don't pay taxes. And they don't go to new casinos that are opening. My big fear is that if we don't recognize Norfolk as a Second Amendment sanctuary, that there will be confiscation, there will be people, there are things that crime will increase, because it's done that in my hometown of Chicago. If the people have to be able to defend themselves. Dead people don't pay taxes. Dead people don't get other people elected. And we need to remember that, because safety is what's at stake here, the safety of the people. And these people behind me, they need to feel protected. They need to know that their first, their second, their third and fourth and fifth amendment rights are protected. So I'm asking you today, to make Norfolk a Second Amendment sanctuary for the good of the people, for the good of the population. I don't know how else to word it, Mr. Mayor, but these are very trying times, and it's a very crazy world today. People have the right to protect themselves. So, having said that, I yield the rest of my time.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Rick Williams, followed by Leslie Fetland.
Mr. Mayor, members of City Council, I'm Rick Williams, 1612 Skyline Drive in Norfolk. I'm here tonight to speak to you again on Second Amendment issues, and I want to urge you once again to listen to the concerns of law-abiding citizens who seek to defend and exercise their Second Amendment constitutional rights. We are talking about law-abiding citizens. I want to remind you that on Rally Day, on January 20th last week, thousands of people gathered in Richmond to make their point heard. And I want to remind you that there was no violence, and they even picked up their own trash after the rally was over. And I submit to you that that calls out the charter of the kind of people that live in this city and that live in the state at large. We are talking about law-abiding citizens. They're proud of their heritage, they're proud of who they are, and they are going to exercise their Second Amendment and other constitutional rights. And yet, members of City Council have seen fit to ignore their concerns. You've heard other speakers remind you that you've failed to put them on the agenda. You've failed to discuss them. There's been no give and take. And you have not even voted on issues of concern to them. That's a problem. It's being ignored. It's being disrespected. It's a failure on the part of City Council to step up and to govern, to engage with citizens who come to you with their concerns. You don't like what we say, engage us. You don't like our offers, our proposals, make a counter. Let's talk, let's negotiate. Let's see what we can do to arrive at a middle ground consensus that we can all live with. But don't ignore us. Please, don't ignore us. We're not going away. We are here. We're law-abiding citizens, and we're voters. We have our concerns. We play by the rules to make those concerns heard. And all we ask is that you give us the time to listen, to engage, to vote. And at the end of the night, if we get something that we can live with, fine. If we don't, we'd like to know we've actually tried.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Leslie Fletton, followed by Jonathan Goldstein.
Good evening, everyone. I'm changing the subject a little bit for a moment. My name is Leslie Fatland, 5914 High Street, West Portsmouth, Virginia. Good evening, all. Today, I will be talking about the jury duty that my husband has been chosen to serve. I'm here in his place because he has to work. The Sixth Amendment guarantees the right of the criminal defendant. However, this should not be at the destruction of the juror. Here are some facts about my situation. My husband was recently chosen to serve on a grand jury. At the present time, this would be a great financial hardship on my family due to the fact that he is the sole breadwinner. He wrote a letter to the judge explaining the financial strain it would put on us. His request to postpone his duty was denied. When my husband arrived to court, he was informed that he was expected to serve as a juror for 3 days per month for the entire year of 2020. His job will only compensate him for 10 days. This means that of the 36 days that he has jury duty, he won't be fully compensated for 26 of them. My family, like 78% of other Americans, is living paycheck to paycheck. Grand jury service financial breakdown. $50 per day paid to the juror, $13 per day for parking fees, and 58 cents per mile for round trip. This is all to be paid 1 month after serving. Juror pay is typically a token amount set by state or local law decades ago and is often very low due to not being adjusted for inflation or rising costs of living. For my family, this means that we will be $189 short on our monthly bills and expenses until we receive the jury duty check in the mail. And after my husband's 10 days of work jury duty pay ends, we will be short additional money per month. Bills have to be paid on time, not 1 month later when the court sends the check. I offer a solution: allow potential jurors to provide the requisite financial documentation as required to demonstrate their financial worthiness. Then, if they are selected, the juror should be adequately compensated in accordance with acceptable documentation as provided by the employer. In closing, if jury duty is one of the most important duties of an American citizen, why then devalue the service with antiquated monetary allowances created decades ago? Why not adequately compensate the people doing their civil service? My family understands that we must uphold this solemn duty. We are simply asking to be compensated fairly for this undertaking or allow us to postpone service due to our current financial difficulty. Thank you for your time.
Miss, can you come back for? I want to make sure I understand. Your husband lives in Norfolk.
Yes.
Lives in Norfolk. Okay. Yes. And is it federal or state?
It's federal. I mean, I think it's state. Yeah. It's the grand jury.
Yeah, so, why don't we have somebody to contact you, because this is not the right chamber?
Yes, I plan to go to my civic league and talk. I'm not sure what to do.
You're right. So let us have someone to contact you afterwards, okay? So you meet Mr. Muse. He's right there in the back of the outside the chamber, and he'll get you in front of the right
I appreciate
party,
it, okay? Because we can't do this.
Yes, I understand. Thank you for coming.
Thank you so much.
Mr. Muse, I'm sure. Jonathan Goldstein, followed by Giovanni Dolmo.
That's a real issue for a lot of people.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council, Mr. City Manager. January of 2019, the City Attorney of Norfolk published a letter in which he stated that his office would no longer prosecute misdemeanor marijuana possession or appeals for misdemeanor marijuana possession. It appears that everybody on this council supported that decision because the city attorney is still, that city attorney is still in office. And that he stated since that he has prosecutorial discretion in these matters. In doing so, this city has pretty much thrown down a gauntlet to the General Assembly, in that they've said that they are willing to disregard an act that was passed by the General Assembly. In so doing, the City of Norfolk becomes almost a poster child for this mentality. And it is a courageous mentality. And I do applaud the City Attorney for his decision and his reasons for that decision. So it would seem that when it comes to a matter of defending the Constitution of the state of Virginia and the Constitution of the United States, the city of Norfolk would also show the same amount of courage and stand up to the General Assembly and make this a Second Amendment city as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Goldstein, also, you're referring to the Commonwealth's attorney? Yeah, Mr. Pishko is the city attorney, but you're referring to the Commonwealth attorney. Thank you for coming.
Mr. Mayor, also, yes. Just to clarify, the Commonwealth's attorney is an elected position by the citizens of Norfolk. We don't appoint him, or have any control.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor,
city council members. My name is Giovanni Domo. I live in 1073 Dubas Drive in Norfolk. It's my first time here, so I have some concerns as I observe as a citizen of Norfolk. I make some observations. I tutor at Bowling Elementary. Not too long ago, a young lady was trying to get snatched into a van from that school. Also, in my neighborhood, my son plays right in front of my home, and a couple of weeks ago, it got shut up in the corner. I had a sense of vulnerability at the time. I didn't know how to really protect my son and his friends or his neighbors. The churches are now getting shot up randomly by people who, for some reason, want to do that. So I have a lot of concerns. I do want to be able to protect myself. I did buy a firearm legally, and it's just very concerning to me that these people who want to do unlawful things can obtain a firearm easily, where someone like me trying to abide the law, abide by the law and do things correctly will be limited. And the law is kind of like holding me back from doing the right thing, but pushing criminals to do things easier. And it's making it tougher for me to protect myself at home and my neighbors if need to be, versus a criminal who wants to just buy an illegal weapon or obtain a legal weapon, however he or she may, and do whatever they want. Yes, I love the police, but at that moment in time, the police wasn't around when the shoot up, when it, my neighborhood got shot up. By the time they get there, there was no one to be found. And it's a scary moment for me as a citizen and living in Norfolk. I have police officers who are friends, but they couldn't be there at that time. And it really made me think how important it is to protect us as citizens. So thank you for your time. I hope that you vote in a way that we could protect us. Thank you.
Thank you. Leo Katsourias, followed by Matthew Adams.
Mr. Mayor and distinguished members of the Norfolk City Council, good evening. Thank you for hearing us today. My name is Leo Katsourea. I am a business owner in Norfolk. I own a business, or part own a business, with my wife. We do brow beautification and body hair removal. It's named Brows and Meows. We're located at 253 West Butte Street on level 2. And I'm here to talk to you today about this whole movement now, the Second Amendment sanctuaries. I don't think people have properly explained the reason why they would like this city and other cities within Virginia to be Second Amendment sanctuaries. And I feel that this is an important point to point out. The Second Amendment is quite clear in saying that our right to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. It's been litigated. The Supreme Court in the Heller decision in 2008 ruled very clearly that our right to keep and bear arms applies to all of us, not just the government or a particular militia. It's to every citizen. Having said that, we still get legislators who come into office with the best of intentions, of course, that believe that their job is to try and change those laws to make it say, to make society safer. However, they try and do so perhaps unwisely by infringing on that right to keep and bear arms. The reason why it's necessary to become a Second Amendment sanctuary is because if they would like to change our right to keep and bear arms, if they would like to remove that, then the Founding Fathers went and instituted a method to do this in our Constitution, and that is through amendments, which requires a great deal of work and cannot be done so easily. As citizens, it's not easy for us to litigate these matters, and oftentimes laws are passed that affect us immediately and cause us to go into litigation but leave us defenseless at the time and create criminals of us. So we ask you to make this a Second Amendment sanctuary so that the people who would like to change our constitutional rights can go through the proper method of doing so rather than affecting us immediately in this way and subverting the Constitution. I'd like to thank you as well for the immediate attention that you paid to the lovely lady there whose husband has the jury duty. I could tell that you're all paying attention and you care a great deal about it. And I know you're going to feel the same about what we're trying to do here today, and we'll put this to a vote. Thank you very much for your time. I yield back to the next person.
Matthew Adams, followed by Rachel Rock.
Mr. Mayor, Council, my name is Matthew Adams. I reside at 7073 Kirby Crescent in Norfolk. The reason I'm here today, Second Amendment. Big surprise, right? Mr. Northam is following in some great men's footsteps. Let's talk about them for a minute. Joseph Stalin took guns away and then killed 5.4 million people. Mao Zedong took guns away in 1935, then proceeded to kill 20 million people. Adolf Hitler took guns away and then killed 13 million people. Pol Pot took guns away, 2 million people. That sounds ridiculous. Things like that don't happen today. But then again, maybe it would be a crime to criticize your leadership. Mr. Northam and his buddy, Mr. Bloomberg, are slowly encroaching on our rights. These aren't gun rights. These are civil rights. These are the rights of all people, whether they be Jewish or black or white, whether they live in 1930s or today. We fought World War II to stop this kind of thing from happening, and here it is today. I served 20 years in the Navy defending you all's rights. Now I'm asking you to defend mine. This only happens once here. We got to get this right the first time. I know this Second Amendment county would hold no legal bearing. The laws that Governor Northam are attempting to pass are not going to make us criminals. They're making him a criminal. They're making his legislature and the people that follow him criminal. And whether it be in the short term or in the long term, they will be held accountable. I ask that you stand with us, make a firm statement against what Governor Northam is trying to do to his people, to your people, and let him know that it will not stand in Norfolk. Thank you very much.
Rachel Rock, followed by John Majors.
Mr. Mayor, Council, you'll be happy to know I don't have anything to add to all that's been said, but I would like to present the mayor and the vice mayor with these. Thank you.
Thank you. John Majors, followed by Maury Kirk.
Sir, I believe those were for PH1.
Yeah. Okay.
PH1 and PH2.
All right. All
not
right.
New business.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Danny Lee Ginn.
My name is Danny Lee Ginn. I reside at 3844 Dare Circle. So let's clear up some end of the year business before we move on to 2020. I had the privilege to go to Lake Taylor High School to talk about what was done in regards to the casino. And I want to address a few things that occurred. I had indicated that I expected the mayor and six of the council members may owe an apology to the citizens of the city for forcing down our throat a negotiation with the Indian tribe. You, Mr. Mayor, then informed me that I should have been aware that when we have a contract, the inflated figures that were provided for us on September 24th, 2019, I should have been aware that they were inflated and skewed figures. I disagree with that because I came here on September 24th, 2019 to get the facts. You had been negotiating, I understand, for close to a year with the Indian tribe behind closed doors and expected you and the council members to have at least adequate figures or close figures as to what it was going to do to benefit the city. So telling me that I should have known what was going on when I wasn't privy what was going on behind closed doors was kind of silly. You then, on September 24th, 2019, after a majority of the people who filled up this very chamber asked you to slow down the process. We wanted to know more about the figures. We wanted to know whether the casino was going to be an Indian tribe casino or a commission casino. But instead of listening to the will of the people and the majority of the people who attended this council meeting, you asked the Indian chief what he wanted done, and he informed you he wanted a vote that night, and you followed his direction. I'm under the impression that you're mayor of this city and that you would have listened to the will of the people. So in the future, I ask two things of you. Please, in the future, do not feed me political garbage that I'm supposed to know something that I was not privy to. And secondly, make the decisions that you were hired for as the mayor of this city and not listen to an Indian chief. Thank you.
Thank you for coming.